In this video, we're going to cover pyruvate pathways and metabolism, looking at the different fates of pyruvate under aerobic and anaerobic conditions. So by the end of this video, you'll see what happens to pyruvate under anaerobic conditions or low oxygen conditions and why fermentation occurs. Then we're going to break down the different pathways under aerobic conditions, and we'll also take a look at how alanine and oxaloacetate are involved. Now, before we break down each fate of pyruvate, let's first do a quick review of how pyruvate is produced via glycolysis. So glycolysis occurs in the cytosol or cytoplasm of the cell. Glucose enters the cell via GLUT transporters or glucose transporters, where it is oxidized in a 10-step process. It's broken down into two phases. So in the preparatory phase, this is where we're investing two ATP molecules. And in the payoff phase, small amounts of ATP and NADH are also going to be produced. So in the payoff phase, this is where we're harvesting energy in the form of NADH and ATP. In both aerobic and anaerobic conditions, we produce pyruvate via glycolysis, converting one molecule of glucose to two molecules of pyruvate. So now let's subtract complexity by first taking a look at what happens to pyruvate under anaerobic conditions, so when oxygen is not present. If we refer back to the glycolysis lecture, NADH was formed in step 6, the first step of the payoff phase when glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate was dehydrogenated. This NADH will then be reoxidized to NAD+ when it donates its electrons to the electron transport chain, where it's going to be accepted by the final electron acceptor, oxygen. So if oxygen is the final electron acceptor, what happens when we are in a hypoxic condition? So when there is low oxygen available, the NADH that is produced by glycolysis cannot be transported to the electron transport chain and be reoxidized by oxygen. And if we can't reoxidize NADH, then there will be insufficient NAD+ to be the electron acceptor when glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized, and that would stop glycolysis. So we need to reproduce NAD+ in another way, and that is where fermentation comes in. So fermentation is when energy is harvested, ATP, but oxygen is not being used. And another thing is the concentration of NAD+ or NADH remains unchanged. And you'll see how this occurs. Now we're going to break down two types of fermentation involving pyruvate, lactic fermentation and ethanol fermentation. So let's begin with lactic fermentation. Lactic fermentation occurs when animal tissues are under low oxygen conditions, so there isn't enough oxygen available for aerobic oxidation. This happens during strenuous exercise when the muscles are working hard and pumping, so for example in sprinting. And our goal here is to regenerate NAD+, and this is done by the reduction of pyruvate to lactate, catalyzed by the enzyme lactate dehydrogenase. Now this is occurring under anaerobic conditions, but there are some cell types like red blood cells that have no mitochondria, so they can't oxidize pyruvate and therefore can produce lactate from glucose with oxygen present. Now, recall back when I mentioned in fermentation, the concentrations of NAD+ or NADH remains unchanged. So why is this the case? When two pyruvate molecules are reduced to two lactate molecules, we produce two molecules of NAD+. And if we refer back to glycolysis, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate turns two molecules of NAD+ to two molecules of NADH. So there is no net change in the number of NAD+ or NADH. Okay, so now we've produced lactate. Now what happens to lactate? Where is this big boy going to go? Well, lactate can actually be recycled. So we produced lactate from pyruvate by lactate dehydrogenase, and now lactate is going to be transported to the liver where it is transformed back to glucose via gluconeogenesis. This requires recovery time to convert lactate to glucose, and we're going to cover this in the gluconeogenesis lecture, but that is lactic fermentation. The other type of fermentation is ethanol fermentation. So this occurs in yeast and other microorganisms where pyruvate is converted to ethanol and carbon dioxide rather than lactate. And this is a two-step process. In the first step, pyruvate is decarboxylated, and this is done by pyruvate decarboxylase. and we require magnesium, and it also has a tightly bound coenzyme thymine pyrophosphate. And thymine pyrophosphate is derived from vitamin B1. Then in the second step, acetaldehyde is going to be reduced to ethanol, and this is done by alcohol dehydrogenase. Okay, so that is ethanol fermentation. And in all fermentations, the hydrogen to carbon ratio of the reactants and products remains the same. So now that we've broken down what happens to pyruvate under anaerobic conditions, let's move on and take a closer look at what happens to pyruvate under aerobic conditions, so when oxygen is present. So the pyruvate that we produced in the cytosol is transported to the mitochondria. It goes through a large opening in the outer mitochondrial membrane, and then it's going to be transported across the inner membrane by a specific passive transporter, mitochondrial pyruvate carrier, or MPC. And in the matrix, it's going to be oxidized to acetyl-CoA and carbon dioxide by pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. So let's take a closer look at this reaction here. So the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex requires 5 coenzymes. So we have thymine pyrophosphate, FAD, coenzyme A, and NAD, and also lipoate. This reaction here is an oxidative decarboxylation, and it's irreversible. So decarboxylation is when we're releasing carbon dioxide. Now, the carboxyl group of pyruvate is removed as a molecule of carbon dioxide, and the two remaining carbons become the acetyl group of acetyl-CoA. So after we've produced acetyl-CoA, acetyl-CoA can then enter the citric acid cycle to generate energy. Or acetyl-CoA can actually be used as the starting material for fatty acid synthesis and sterol synthesis. In this reaction, NADH is formed, and NADH is an important electron carrier. So it's going to carry these electrons to the electron transport chain, where it's going to be accepted by the final electron acceptor, oxygen. Now, there's another NADH that will donate to the electron transport chain, and that is from the oxidation of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. These electrons will be used to drive ATP synthesis, and we cover this in the oxidative phosphorylation lecture. So that is what happens to pyruvate under aerobic conditions. So now let's move on to the next pathway of pyruvate, and that is in gluconeogenesis, where pyruvate is converted to oxaloacetate. Now, we're going to cover this in more detail in the gluconeogenesis lecture, but essentially, gluconeogenesis occurs primarily in the liver and to a lesser extent in renal cortex of the kidney. So gluconeogenesis is when we're synthesizing glucose from non-carbohydrate sources. This happens during fasting, starvation, or vigorous exercise, so when our glycogen is depleted. And our objective here is to maintain blood glucose levels. And for gluconeogenesis to occur, we need carbon skeletons and energy. So we can use pyruvate to achieve this. So the pyruvate we produce in the cytosol is transported into mitochondria, where it's converted to oxaloacetate by pyruvate carboxylase. And we need ATP to drive this reaction and the coenzyme biotin. Now, oxaloacetate is a substrate for gluconeogenesis, but it's also a citric acid cycle intermediate. And oxaloacetate needs to move out of the mitochondria into the cytosol. But because the membrane doesn't have an oxaloacetate transporter, oxaloacetate needs to be converted to malate first. And this is done by the mitochondrial malate dehydrogenase enzyme. Then, malate is going to be transported out the cell through a transporter. And this is what's called the malate shuffle. malate shuttle. Then again, the malate is shuffling out of the cell, so I guess that can help you remember it. When malate is in the cytosol, it is converted back to oxaloacetate by the systolic malate dehydrogenase. And here, we are regenerating NADH. So then oxaloacetate is then converted to phosphoenol pyruvate, or PEP for short. And this is catalyzed by phosphoenol pyruvate. And in this reaction, we're going to be removing carbon dioxide. Okay, so now we've produced PEP. What happens now? Well, then the reaction is going to follow the pathway of gluconeogenesis, or the reversal process of glycolysis. So that is how oxaloacetate is involved in the different pathways of pyruvate. So now let's move on to the last pathway, and we're going to take a look at the glucose-alanine cycle. And we covered this in great detail in the amino acid metabolism lecture. But essentially, Alanine can transport amino groups to the liver via the glucose-alanine cycle. So during muscle contraction, glycolysis is occurring. So we're converting glucose to pyruvate. So pyruvate levels are high in muscles. Now, if you've seen the amino acid metabolism lecture, we discussed how glutamate accepts amino groups. So in muscle, glutamate is going to transfer its amino groups to pyruvate, producing alanine. And this is catalyzed by alanine amino transferase. So then alanine is going to travel into the blood and to the liver. And in the cytosol of liver cells, the amino groups from alanine is donated to alpha-ketoglutarate, and we produce pyruvate and glutamate. And the enzyme here again is alanine amino transferase. So let's take a closer look at this transamination reaction that's occurring here. So alanine transfers its amino groups to alpha-ketoglutarate, forming pyruvate and glutamate. So as we can see here, this is where the amino group is, and it's going to be transferring the amino group to alpha-ketoglutarate, so forming pyruvate and glutamate. So once alpha-ketoglutarate accepts that amino group, it becomes glutamate. So then pyruvate can be converted back to glucose via gluconeogenesis, and that is the glucose-alanine cycle. So that is pyruvate pathways and metabolism. In this lecture, we learned what happens to pyruvate under anaerobic conditions or low oxygen conditions and why fermentation occurs, so harvesting energy, but we're not using oxygen. And we also broke down what happens to pyruvate under aerobic conditions and how pyruvate is involved in gluconeogenesis and the glucose-alanine cycle. Thank you for watching this video. Make sure you subscribe to EKG Science so you don't miss a single lecture. And remember, subtract complexity and slow down. To study the next lecture, simply click the next video, or you can view the entire metabolism playlist. Hey, stop procrastinating!